So welcome everyone. Today is our third session. So after physiotherapy on day one, nutrition on day two, we have now moved to a very important topic, which is parent psychology. And today our guest lecturer is Rekha Nahar. So please give a round of applause for her. So to give you a short introduction of her, Rekha Nahar is the founder of Tender Therapy and is well trained and qualified for creative play therapist and counselor from Play Therapy International, UK, in association with Leeds Beckett University and Singapore respectively. She's a qualified counselor and she has done her qualification from Melbourne and is currently dedicated herself to work with young Indian children and families. And one of the most important things is that Rekha is a chess parent. So she has two kids who are strong chess players, very young. So that makes her a perfect person to talk on this subject. So Rekha, welcome to this and over to you.
Thank you, Sagar, for such a nice and brief introduction of mine. It was quite impressive to hear that. Okay, before the newcomers have walked in, I think the parents who are sitting in front has got an opportunity to pick up few musical instruments. There are few more. I think there are 2-3 more if somebody would like to volunteer. Okay, continuation to Sagar, what he has spoken about me. Let me give a brief introduction of myself. You know, I am no different than you all today. I am in the same shoes of what you are in today. Along with being a psychologist, I'm similar in the same shoes like you. I'm a parent. I'm a chess parent. I have a chess on my parent designation, which puts me in the same shoe like yours. Okay, so this is very important topic for me to discuss today. Rather than me, I think it's very important for you all, and I can see from the crowd that has come here is so eagerly waiting to have the answers of the questions that they have passed on in last few days to my colleague. My name is Rekha Nahar, as Sagar has introduced me, and I have traveled globally to understand people and children from a cultural perspective. May it be sports, may it be behavior, may it be emotional, social, behavioral difficulties, the cultural perspective plays an important role, and also the environment that the parents create for a child plays an important role for a child to grow and evolve. The first slide, what you can see here, is none other than my husband and my son Rajveer. My son Rajveer, who is now 10 years old, but my husband is also currently present here, and it's his birthday today. It's the 7th October. Yes, and I'm really glad that he is being a part of my first ever talk, and the new things are beginning on his birthday. Thank you so much for being here. Okay, so we just talk about here. What can you observe about this image on this slide, if anybody has to talk about it? Just one line, maybe a few words.
Father and son.
Father and son, that's relationship, okay.
Like dad, like son.
Yeah. Like dad, like son. Can you see the matching of the attire, what they are like? Somebody is observing the attitude as well?
Happy
father, happy son. It's so important. And can you feel that touch? There is an amazing connection between a father and a son. Can you see that? So today, we all are here to understand how we can touch the hearts of our own child. That is the most important thing for them to evolve. May it be chess, may it be any career in their life. So let's begin. Okay, so my introduction is already done by Sagar. I don't need to say too much about it. And this is my family. I just graduated in 2016 from Monash University, Melbourne. I wanted to, this, my curiosity is to study child and relationship better. So I traveled to Monash and I said, you know what, I need to do my master's. I'm not very happy with diploma. I need to get educated more. So my family actually flew. My kids were very happy. They were screaming and shouting from the stage. It's like from the audience, yay, mama on the stage. And I'm like, wow, there's a motivating factor. Like they have been, they're a part of my happiness. So now it's my turn to do the same. These are the points which I could gather from the parents who listed down, who were really kind enough to list down their concerns. And we are first of all going to focus on the points which are actually concerning to these parents here. These are the points which are being brought up by the parents for, whose children are into chess purely, and the age group is from 13 to 15. So we are looking at the like development, like, you know, the teenagers, the early teenagers. So we are going to see how it is impacting their chess career. So the first foremost concern which was raised was, how do we prepare children for chess? We just don't understand. We have spent years and years together to train about chess, to bring in new coaches, books, everything. How about that? First of all, we need to understand the child has picked up this sport naturally, or it's due to the parental pressure, or it is due to the peer pressure, first and foremost. If it is coming naturally, then there are different ways to handle. If it really only the parents want them to be a grandmaster, there is always a different way to handle, which can always be sorted out first. So first thing first is recognize and accept your child uniqueness. As you would know, and you might have known about so many grandmasters, and Sagar will be the right person to say that, there are many grandmasters who have their own style. None of the grandmaster is same to other. There is no similarity apart from the few triads. So let's accept this. Let's accept the child the way they are and what is the sport that they like and to what extent. Second, the next point which you need to focus on is, if there is a, you know, you have already done your homework well, you have your coaches done, then let's have a periodic, you know, this like a discussion with the coaches and the child. That speaking to child is another subject which is going to be coming to the next slide. But I think interval discussion with the coaches will always help you to understand that how to prepare a child. Then limit external distraction to greater extent in a balanced manner. Why do I put in the balanced manner? Why this balanced manner is so important in this line? Of course, a chess child needs to be away from the distraction. I hope everybody would agree with me, right? Yeah. We really can't be normal child. We really can't be normal parent. Let's accept it, right? We cannot go for parties anywhere, anytime we want. We cannot celebrate our festivals anytime we want. We have to sacrifice our movies. We have to sacrifice our parties. Yes, I can see that giggle, see that hoo-hoo. I can understand that. It's coming from the parent, right? We just can't be normal because it's, we are doing something special. It's not, it shouldn't be stressful for the child nor for the parent. Let's enjoy the journey. And the discussion with the coaches and taking a regular review from the experts would definitely make it easy. Encourage curiosity. When it comes to a child, what would be the curiosity like when it comes to a tournament or when it comes to the top three position? What is the score? Can you just be more specific on what curiosity may be for a child when he's coming for a tournament? If I have to ask you, what is the curiosity like for your child when he's coming for the tournament?
Multiple curiosities. Of course, he's on performance, he's curious who he's going to meet over there, he's going to meet his friends, he's going to meet his idol.
Okay.
Be a part of the community. That's big curiosity.
That's lovely. What's your name?
Marcus.
So, Marcus here, my friend, has given me a very good point, and it's a personal curiosity what he's sharing today about his child. He's saying that, am I going to meet my friends there? Who are going to be my friends? Am I going to feel idols there? And what is going to be like? My performance anxiety. Am I going to perform well? It's a world cadet. It's a world youth championship. So let's begin to talk about this. Give them an ease. Don't just push them in a tournament. Like before we go to any kind of a movie if we are going for any wedding, how do we brief them? You know, listen, we are going for, you know, so-and-so's wedding. They are this relative of yours. We need to behave well. We need to enjoy in certain way. So this is the same thing that we need to also ease out the curiosity of a child in terms of performance. Let's accept each and every question of the child in a very, very acceptable manner. The next one is, how do we motivate children? Lack of concentration, lack of focus. My child doesn't feel very confident in the tournaments. He feels distracted. We don't get performance. These were the few pointers which were highlighted by the parents in the last few days, in the last five rounds. And thank you so much, parents for bringing this up. Because I have also experienced the same with my own daughter. Here, Husi, the girl here, she's my daughter, Anisha. She's 1 year old now, but she's 7 year old now, like at the moment. In this picture, she's 1 year old. And here, my son is helping her to walk. So can anybody point out what is the difference between the first image and the second image, please? I want to see if you're awake. Are you listening to me? Can anybody tell me what is the difference between the first image and the second image? Sorry? Okay, there is an unseen support. There is an unseen support which is visible in this picture. So we are the unseen support. We, the parents, are nowhere in the picture, but still we are the strongest support for a child to say, okay, we are there. Take your few steps ahead and you will be confident. And what is that you can see in the second one? What has changed? So now the siblings are coming into picture. The parental support has been enough. And now the sibling is coming into picture. But can you see the structure of this girl, little girl? Is she looking confident? She is nicely taking the steps forward. And this is all because of the parental support which was initially given when she really needed it. Yeah? So the hugs, smiles, laughter are wonderful parenting tools. Can anyone share one experience? And I would share mine too. Can anyone share one experience when the child lost the game and you were not able to react appropriately? It'd be a good forum to discuss, honestly. Just please, if it'd be really nice if someone can say that, okay, fine. There had been one occasion where I felt I shouldn't have behaved that way. Since I will come up with mine. In Albania, there was World Schools tournament which was happening. It was, my daughter was just 5.5 or 6. And she was playing under-7 World Schools tournament in Albania 2017. The first 3 rounds, she was 3-on-3. She defeated the world schools champion, which is Lakshana Subramaniam. And from the 4th round till the 8th round, she lost all the games. And back to back, she was losing each and every game. We parents were totally clueless what has that gone wrong? And what has changed in my child's performance or behavior or coaching or my behavior, which is holding her back to perform, you know, in the tournament hall? I was just not able to understand what happened. That's where I contacted Sagar. Sagar, do you remember? I messaged you about it. Yeah, it was long time, 2017. We are in 2019. So I was just discussing with, and the best part, you know what? In the fifth, the third last round, when she was getting ready for the tournament, my daughter Anaisha told me, "Mama, I'm very scared." I said, "Okay, you have done your coaching right. What is that is scaring you?" "Mama, in the tournament hall, there are so many small children like me. What if I lose to those small girls? Will you be proud of me if I lose to them? Will you be the same mama to love me?" And I was like, she was not worried about the tournament. She was worried about me. Am I going to be the same mother, the same emotional mother, the same touching mother, or we as a parents going to be the same? And that she really taught me a biggest lesson in life. And that was the beginning of my journey in chess. And at that very moment, I realized, for a child, it's not about the performance inside the tournament hall. It's about, they look up to the parents' micro expressions. How are my parents going to react? Am I going to be accepted the way I am right now, before and after my round is over? That is the main concern. So parents, it's my great request to hold the hand of your child, and in a nice way, I think you are the best people to understand the child, your own child. Do not, the micro expressions of your face is well read by a child. The coaches will tell them, the peers will tell them, but what the parents will react will stay with them forever. It's very simple. So please, you know, we have to be very mindful to our micro expressions compared to our words, what we speak in front of our children, especially when the child has lost a particular game. Because the child itself is already threshed, it's already painful for him to lose that particular round. And in the journey from the time that the child comes out from the tournament hall till the child faces the parent, he's just scared of that one sentence. Will my father react in the same way? Will my mother accept my loss? How is she going to react? Is she going to be angry? Is she going to be happy? I have no clue. So let's make that experience better. Just give a nice touch. If we cannot put our emotions in words, let's not do that. Just hold the child's hand. Just keep a hand on the shoulder. I think they're tall enough to keep the shoulder, right? Hand on the shoulder. Let's do that. Let's give that extra touch. Let's give that unseen support to the pair, to the children. And just see for the next few tournaments how it works for a child. Yeah? The next point which was brought to me was, how do I deal with parent family affairs, peer pressures? Other children are doing some other sport. I am doing this boring chess. I cannot go out of my house. I cannot enjoy like a normal child. I have to put in extra effort every day before my tournament. I cannot cope up with my school studies. What do I do? Am I normal? Am I not normal? So let's bring out, I've just put it, this picture here, which was very special to me. I can see my daughter, which was clicked from inside. I can see my daughter, how she's on her tournament table. Exhausted, completely. She's trying to focus. And on the same, she's the same girl who's sitting over here. Enthusiastic, free bird, wants to enjoy. So let's strike a balance in their own life. You know, I tell you, when you give a slight short break, the child will always come with double energy to the thing which they already have done it for many years. The chess is not going to be out of their mind and their soul, for sure. The child who has already done it for a couple of years, it's going to be continuing for years and years together. It's just that we as a parents need to keep them going on. Let's not be a target oriented or a result oriented at every tournament we go to. It's just that we need to understand what was the time frame before they started up this particular tournament. Whether they have done enough coaching, they had enough rest, they had enough good food, they had enough break. So all these unsaid points which are not related to chess should also be taken into consideration. Attitude and confidence. Is it different or is the same? My child is confident today, but he lacks attitude when he's playing the game. Is it the same or is it different? I need the answers from the parents who are sitting behind, please. Is attitude and confidence same for you all?
Confidence is one of the attributes of attitude.
So confidence is one of the attributes of attitude. So you mean to say, can you see this picture? Can somebody describe this picture? I see a lady smiling in the blue dupatta. Does she want to be a part of it? Anyway.
Son is enjoying it. Maybe he's having an attitude where you can't push and your daughter is confident
that she... All right. I think... Mr. Venkatesh, I think you have hit the right point here. That my son is showing, it's full of attitude. He's like on the bike. He has got all the comfort. And he is so happy to ride. He has got all the attitude to be on the bicycle. And look at my poor daughter. She's just 1 year old. But she has that confidence to push the brother who is 4 year old on a bicycle. And she's not giving up. So that no giving up attitude, your confidence needs to be there in this sport as well. No matter what size you are of. Just situational basis. You cannot see any parent around. So sometimes we need to let the child do whatever they want, experiment their own strength and weaknesses. When there are the tournaments which is like not rating or maybe they're just an open fiddle, and let them be on their own where they can show, they can exhibit their attitude, their confidence, which we can also make a note, what went well in the open fiddle tournament, which is not going well in the World Youth Championship. So this is our observational study which will work on for the child. The child will not be in the position to talk about it whatsoever. Whatsoever. So please do not forget that image of that unseen support. The hand is very important. Thank you, Venkatesh. Hit on. The next is expectations of the performance versus real-life, real-time standard. I've given a very simple example here, just to understand. What can you see in this image? Anyone need mic? Please come on. What is this image like? Someone from the back? Is it clear? Can everybody see this?
Is that kid in pain or something?
Oh. What's your good name? Your good name?
Shavanti.
Shavanti, I like your interaction. Honestly, I like the way you're interacting, which is motivating me as well.
Thank you.
Yes. So when there is an eye contact, when there is an interaction, it definitely motivates. Imagine I am a child and you are a parent. I'm asking you a question and you are interacting. That is the first point of motivation that we are giving to our child. Let's do it. Okay, so Shavanti, yes.
He's in pain or something.
But still?
He's trying to do that.
He's trying to do it. So he is trying to keep up to the expectations of the parents. I'm just trying to relate this. The child who is playing chess, so he is in pain, but he's still trying to climb up the ball. Here, the supporters are there, but he is just focusing on his own performance. He's trying to be there. There is a comparison. When we enter a tournament, we have always somebody else to compare our child's performance with. This boy has been doing from past 3 years. And you have been doing chess from past 6 years. What is your performance like? Why are you not growing at the same level? Why you have not gone in your strength? So these are the questions that comes into our mind and which downflows to our child's emotions in some or the other way. So this is the comparison happening. The people are climbing, the others are also climbing the same way. Here he is going steady, enjoying, but it is very hard for him to be at the same position all the time. So parents, it's my kind request to you. It's really hard for any child to keep up the expectations for 100% for every tournament and tournament coming over and over again. So let's be open. Let's accept that there would be ups and downs in a particular tournament. It's just that we need to hold the hand of the child, be with the child, because honestly, the chess would stay with them forever if you would stay with them forever in the same emotional way. It all depends on us. It's the parent who makes the complete difference to a child's evolution. Let's give them. If they all are motivating them, they are cheering up for them, nobody is holding his hand. He has to do his bit. Similarly, the chess child has to fight his own battle in every tournament. What we can do, what the coaches can do, can only be at the outside of the chess tournament hall. Right? We cannot go inside and do anything for the child. So let's accept it. Also understand that it is equally hard for a child to sustain at that particular height. Parental anxiety and child's low moment. This is a picture when my son had fallen down in Singapore. And we parents, I was in my college and my husband was in his office. We just got a call that my son has fallen down and there was nobody for him to take care of him. My daughter, who was just 1.5 years old, she knew where is the sofra medicine because that is what all she knew. She quickly went and she came up with this, Bhaiya, the touch, the human touch. At that very moment of time, my son did not feel that my father is not there, my mother is not around. They are on their way. But what was important is the first interaction with the person who is around you. And if you as a parent are always going to be with your child for a chess tournament, make sure that you bring that extra touch, extra emotions, extra smile, extra hug, extra love in the chess tournament to make sure that they complete the chess tournament in a right spirit. Where you have started, finish till the very end. Do not let your spirit die because they are grasping that kind of a potential from you parents. If you give up in life, that is what they are reading between the lines, that if it's just been 3 years and my father has said, okay, fine, stop chess, no need to do it. And you know what? You're no good. Others are doing from just 2 years and you're there. Let's not that scenario come into your life. Each child is special. Hold your child's hand and just be with the child. The sport will stay with them or don't or not. But maybe they'll become a great human being one day. Balance between the academics and sports. along with the confidence in both. Too much of expectations from the parents, yeah? Like, this was the feedback coming from 7 parents to me. This was the question that how do they strike a balance between education and these sports activities? But I think in this 21st century, where education has been given such a great importance, along with the sports, it is very important for each parent who is a professional or a businessman to think about the education that, oh, what if the chess doesn't stay in the child's life? What is he going to do after that? Is he going to be a chess coach? Or he is going to be a grandmaster? Or not a grandmaster? Then what is he going to do? Because he has never studied in his life. What is that he's going to do after 10 years if he's just done chess and no studies at all? So this was the question which has come into the mind, that we are expecting them to win the trophy or the title or the, you know, top 3. We need the performance in terms of, you know, other stuff. But what about the studies? So I was just going through this video which was done by Vishwanathan Anand. In like a short minute, he has explained it so well that how did he cope up with the studies? I would not be giving any other example but then Vishwanathan Anand, because I think the kind of immense time that he has given to this sport.
Did you have any sort of pushback either at home or in town, in Chennai, for example, where you both grew up, as far as, oh, he's playing chess full time at this point? You know, is it something that he should be doing? Is it something that he should be looking for school and college and a job? Did that come up?
No, I was very lucky in 2 senses. One is my parents were very open-minded. And again, I really feel in the 70s and 80s that my parents were very relaxed about the amount of time I was spending with chess. It was very unusual. In those days, whenever you spoke to somebody, they would say, you know, I really wanted to do the sport, but my father kept saying, get a job. So that sort of story. But my parents were, but I also didn't make it that hard for them, because the deal always, unspoken, was I wouldn't let my studies go, I'd find some way to combine it. So for the 10th and 12th, I actually stopped playing chess for 3 months so that I could focus on the exams. And, but you know, the 9th standard and the 11th, I got to travel a lot more. Yeah, so we adjusted a bit. And in fact, at many moments in my career, I found it very useful to study. By this I mean that at some point you hit a wall where you're not getting any better and you can't see why. And then you spend 3 months suddenly switching to your exams. And then you come back and this wall has disappeared. And you start to play more freely. You can explain this in a way that you're learning concepts, but you're not able to put them into piece. And then you do something else for a while. And then when you come back, suddenly the chessboard looks a bit clearer. Something to that effect. Or maybe it's just that you're playing too much chess, you're saturated, and you need a break. And so this enforced break of school worked.
Thanks, Akash. So, what a Vishy Anand. I hope everybody could hear what he said. Did everybody could hear what he said?
Yes.
So it was a very positive way that he has taken, that the studies was like a stopgage arrangement. It was like a break for him. So if he's getting saturated by the coaching, go learn the few another concept which is not really chess. Give yourself a break and come back with a double enthusiasm. And this would make him better in the chess performance as well. And would strike a balance. So what he has picked up is an important years of his career is the 10th and the 12th standard. So parents, let's focus. In case if you are still driven by chess, take an individual choice. Speak to your child. What is that your child needs to want? Because it is, trust me, it's a very individual perspective. And the child of 13 years and 14 years, I think 8th and the 9th standard, they already know which subject needs to be taken, how to be studied, what is the future plan, whether the chess or any other thing. So let's give a child a chance. Let's give every bit and pieces their emotions and expressions. Let's study them so clearly. So I, just to close this session, the people who have got the musical instrument in their hand, I want one person to start first, the one who has got in the front row. So I want to begin with the rhythm. So I'm going to come closer to the person who has got, and that person has to start playing, and the other have to keep adding to the music. They don't have to stop. So the one who has started first will be adding on to the, and it will continue. So you will continue till the end. You are the first one, the chosen one. Marcus, let's do it.
Still going on in mind, and that vibes, you can still feel the vibes. You can still feel the same vibes inside.
I can see your eyes very emotional at the moment.
Yes, yes.
You're feeling too emotional with this kind of a music.
Right.
You know what she said? That the rhythm, after we all stopped, she could still feel that music. Imagine if the child has lost the game, and the child comes out with his emotions, and we have our own words and our music to play on him, and after we are gone away from his sight, do you think that the music will still be on in his heart as well? He would be still thinking about you, your words, your emotions, your anger, your expressions. It would still stay in his mind. So this was the example where I wanted to set that, you know what, this rhythm is so powerful, your words for your child are so powerful, use them mindfully, because the music would stay in your child's mind. And yes, the people who have got the sheet, who have been trying to color, the people who have not got the musical instrument, where has it reached, Chandni? Can we get it back, please? Each one, okay, so what I have done is, the people who have not got a chance to get the musical instrument, they had got a sheet of paper and a few colors. They had to pick one color and draw anything on that paper. And they had to pass on to the other person, but has to use another color. Can everybody see this? Who has started this? Who was the first one to draw? What's your name?
Shaina.
This was your property. Initially, you were the first one, founder of this, the mother of this baby. Did you expect this on your property? Uh-oh. Shaina never expected this on her property. She had different dreams. She had a different image that could come on this. But just because over the over it kept passing on the people, it just like it went to different hands with different colors. So just imagine this is a child's life. We are the creator of the child's life because we are the mothers or the parents. It has gone to different states, different hands, different tournaments, different people. And what has happened on this paper? Just cannot figure out. So let's make a routine. Let's build connection. Do not let your child just hear the music from everyone. Let's have it very close and tight. Let's keep your baby as your baby. Let's not anybody take it emotionally. So thank you so much, parents, for being a part of this session. I hope I could make a little change, bring a little shift in your ideas. And if yes, please do share a feedback. Chandni would be here today and on 9th and 10th. Please leave your feedback. And you are most welcome to write on to... I think Sagar will take it over. Guys, did you have... Like, could I get a shift? Like, if I have to know.
Yes. Yes.
Marcus, thank you so much. I think you started that rhythm very well. I was enjoying too. I saw Preeti Bhabhi. You were thoroughly enjoying the music. You were in a different rhythm altogether. I think you were in the meditation state, isn't it? Yeah. So thank you, parents. I'm here because of you. And please do give me a chance to touch more lives like this. Bring in more queries. I ensure that on the 9th and the 10th, any personal queries which is that you're going to be highlighting for you personally, please do come. I would be more than happy to be with you, to hold your hand, to keep that unseen support for your child.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. My numbers and everything are here mentioned on this, and also Sagar would have, and it is, I would post it with the help of Sagar somewhere. Yeah, Sagar, over to you.
So, thank you so much, Rekha. One thing which I always feel is, let's say when you take a book or when you go to some show or when you go to a workshop or something, even if you get one thing to think about or one thing which makes you think, I think your time is well utilized and you have made very good use of that moment. So the same thing I feel happened here. Everyone got something to think about thanks to Rekha. There were points which were, some of them would be known to you, but because they were put up here together, I'm sure you are all thinking about it now. It will be very interesting to see how you will react when the game gets over today. It's like direct application in 2 hours. So, thank you so much, Rekha, for doing this, and let's give a last round of applause to her for this. So this video will be put up on YouTube, just like the previous two. If any of you have missed the first two videos, you can have a look at it on ChessBase India YouTube channel. This one will also be put up along with Rekha's contact details. And it is also over here, so you can take that up. And we will meet again on 9th. Tomorrow is a rest day. So on 9th at 4 p.m. and that topic will be player psychology. Today was parent psychology. On 9th it will be player psychology. So thank you all for coming.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm joined here by Rekha Nahar, who gave right now a lecture on psychology, parent psychology, at the World Youth Championships. Rekha, how was your experience and what did you feel about the entire thing?
So, I began with the issues which were concerns which were highlighted by the parents before my talk started. So, I took this opportunity to collect few of the concerns in way of writing. And it was very much, it was, you know, I was very happy to highlight those concerns in my talk. And when I saw the parents were interacting and taking part of it, maybe not all, but few of them. And I completely understand that the others who were listening to me were into their deep thoughts, that how do they apply in their own real life. So I think it was one of the best sessions that I ever had. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to highlight the main concerns for the children who are playing chess and of the parents who are in the age bracket of their child to be in between 13 to 15 years of age who are still into chess. So
when you took these feedbacks from the parents, what was the most common one that you got?
Attitude and confidence. So there were almost like out of 25, there were almost like 11 to 12, they were concerned about the attitude and the confidence about their child. Three of them spoke about like lack of confidence, lack of focus, distraction. But as you said that, you know, what we do after the game, after they have lost the game, is very impactful for the next game. So when you talk about that the child is losing the confidence, we need to not look ahead that what happened next. We need to always go through the back and go to the roots that what happened before they started playing the particular round. So I think if every parent understands and observes the micro expressions of the child, the feelings of the child which is attached to a tournament, then it will really be helpful for a parent to say, okay, fine. They can highlight, you know, the they can always differentiate between the attitude and the confidence and work on them as per the child's behavior or the child's individual needs.
So you have a very unique combination. You are a parent of two chess players and you also have studied psychology. So what do you think helps you in this more?
Wow, that's my favorite question, Sagar. Actually, if I be like just a chess parent, but having a psychology knowledge, I'm able to observe myself, my behavior, the child's behavior, the child's expression mindfully every moment with every tournament. And I do a lot of homework, not because of their chess. I do a lot of homework understanding my own children. What happened before the round? How was their training session before the tournament? How was their mood? How was their sleep? How was their food intake? I think these all things matter. Of course, every parent would take care of it. But what extra care this psychology has helped me to take care of is their expressions, their unspoken words, their eye movements, their needs, their emotional needs, I would say, the emotional needs which is I really can help them with. So it in totality, the psychology subject helps me to understand my child in a better way and become a great chess player, because I would tell myself that it has been 2.5 years that I am been with my children in this journey of chess, but I have never seen myself, honestly, I've never seen myself seen in that anxiety mode more than 10% in this 2.5 years of journey. Yes, when my children also play on a top tables, there is little of positive anxiety or a positive stress, but it's just very positive. It's not that it really takes a toll on my child.
Yeah, this was what I was going to ask you. Yeah. When you gave the lecture over here, are you able to practice this as a chess parent in the heat of the moment? Are you able to get these things in your own life?
That's a very beautiful question again, because yes, as a chess parent, I cannot differentiate myself at many times that am I a chess parent or just a psychologist, because after all, it's just me as a one person. But when I work with my children, I also keep talking to my coaches on a regular basis. How was the coaching class? What was the mood like? What is that extra effort in terms of their sleep or food or anything, concentration? So I do a lot of, like, I maybe make them practice yoga in case of concentration. Then I give them a nice break in case if they say, you know, if the coaches say that, you know, she's been sitting for 2 hours but really not even able to understand. So I try to explain the coach rather than the child, that, you know, I explain the coach, you know what, can we just have a break of half an hour? because if the child is not in taking it, then you know there's nothing what I can do, but let's take a break so that she comes back with a double fire. So in meanwhile, when I take a break with my child, I make sure that I do those lovely things which my child is really fond of, and taking a confirmation from my child that, hey, look, you know, now this 30 minutes of the break is getting over. Now let's do chess and let's get back to work and let's be serious, because this is what we are looking at in this tournament. And this works beautifully and wonderfully for my children. Yeah.
Okay. And finally, you have this tender play. Yes. What is it called?
The tender therapy.
The tender therapy. Where is it situated? And if people want to contact you and take advice from you related to psychology, how can they do that?
So my clinic is located in Koregaon West, which is on SV Road. And in case if you want, I can always post my e-card onto your ChessBase India or personally send it to you, so that it can be circulated on your website.
We'll put that up in the links to this video.
Yes. So we can have the WhatsApp number and the contact number and the address, which they can approach through WhatsApp, and then we can have one-to-one, you know, sessions with the parents, or maybe we can just understand that what extra help that do we need, that the chess parents would need.
Well, Rekha, it was a pleasure talking to you, and thank you for coming here and doing this. It was very useful for the entire chess community.
Thank you so much once again, Sagar. It was a great opportunity for me to talk about it, and it is one of my favorite subjects, that how that parents can be so, the parental support is very impactful for the child's evolvement. And I think this is what my motive of life is. How can we see a family happy? It's only when we see a child happy. But the child is completely dependent on the mesosystem, like the family. So ultimately, we need to fine tune some parenting skills which will help the child to grow better.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.